been as dark as it is right now. And then you read what these hymn writers wrote about their experiences in living for Jesus and serving Jesus. Man's always been what man is, and God's always been what God is, and people that side with God have always found themselves going against the current and the flow of the thing. And so I appreciate those good hymns of faith and trust and confidence in God. Okay, let's try to take these announcements in order. We'll do the best we can with them. Nursing home service, 2 o'clock today. House-to-house visitation, 3 o'clock today. Prayer meeting at 5 o'clock today. Evening service at 6 o'clock today. Teen class fellowship and bonfire following the evening service tonight. I'll be preaching this week in Bossier City, Louisiana, just outside of Shreveport. I've been home 5 weeks in a row. That's something I looked at, got looking back. That's the longest. I hadn't been home that long in a decade. It's been 10 years since I went 5 weeks without preaching any kind of meetings. Our marriage is still intact. And we thank the Lord for His grace. And so, but be heading out to Louisiana, preaching out there this week, Brother Stephen Sorrell. Holy Women class Monday night. But the Land School of the Bible meets Tuesday and Wednesday night this week. A Sure Foundation, Attributes of God. That class be Tuesday and Wednesday this week. Youth rally this Friday. Central Baptist Church, Winter Haven, leaving church house at 4 o'clock. Outdoor adventure, Saturday, February 21, boys and girls ages 5 through 12. There's a sign-up sheet in the lobby. You can just write your name around Landon so you can fit it in there somewhere or another. Landon is going this Saturday. All right, Daytona 500 Evangelism, Sunday, February 22nd. This is a big event for us. If they get the ticket sales they want, there'll be 100,000 people or more coming over that ramp and into that raceway. And they'll get to hear the gospel as they approach the ramp, as they walk up the ramp, as they cross the ramp, as they come down the ramp. Praise God. Be a blessing. We can report our extended outreach attendance numbers next week. We'll break all attendance records for Bible Baptist Church. We hope to have over 100,000 for preaching next week. And then church-wide yard sale. We'll do this once a year. It'll be February the 28th. Bring in items we can sell starting February 22nd. Do not bring in items we can't sell. So we do that once a year. This year is to raise money for our young people going on a mission trip this summer. So if you can help with that, that would be great. Okay, we got 3 starting places this morning. 3 places to start. 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. 1 John chapter 1, 2 Samuel 12, the Old Testament, 1 John chapter 1 in the New, and then Psalm 51, 2 Samuel 12, 1 John 1, Psalm 51, and we will visit the passages in that order. We have spent this year looking at the fall of David, as recorded in 2 Samuel 11. We then looked at the confrontation as God sent Nathan the prophet in to rebuke David for his sin. And the last 2 times we have rejoiced to see David acknowledge, "I have sinned before the Lord." This morning, it will be our great pleasure, after these many, many weeks of down, 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 down went David, it'll be our great pleasure to see how David was brought from the pit by God, how David was taken from that miry, miry place into which he had fallen and reestablished upon the solid rock. Let's pray together. Father, help me this morning to tell the truth, to speak the truth in love, to make it clear, to make it plain. Father, I pray this morning for all those that have come desiring to hear your truth, and especially, Lord, our prayer this morning is for those who came with no intention of hearing your truth. God, would you work in every heart today, those that really want you to make a change in their lives, and those that did not realize how much they needed you to make a change in their life. Would you help us, each and every one, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. 2 Samuel 12, Verse number 13. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. What I do not find in that rapid transition, I do not find any reference to David's emotional response. I do not find any reference to David's psychological response. I do not find there anything about whether David knelt or did not kneel, whether David came to an altar or did not come to an altar, whether David... There are so many things that man requires because we want to see something with our eyes to convince us. The truth of the matter is, David had first to deal with God. The truth of the matter is, you have first to deal with God. How you respond emotionally as you do that or afterward, that's a topic for another day. How you respond psychologically, how you respond socially, that's conversation for another time. Whether you walk this direction or kneel that direction or perform this ritualistic act or perform that traditional activity, all of that we can talk about some other time. The fact of the matter is, our God is so gracious. Our God is so merciful. That where He finds true repentance, He will grant true forgiveness in an instant. Where He finds a genuine turning from sin, He will impart a genuine blessing in a moment of time. That's what He wants to do. We cut ourselves off from God's blessing by our sin. We keep ourselves cut off from God's blessing by our refusal to turn from that sin. And all the while the Lord is waiting, 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 waiting. He's so kind. He's so gracious. He's so merciful. He could have built a boat for Noah and his family, but He built an ark so anybody that wanted to sail could have done so. He had designs for Sodom and Gomorrah and would carry them out, but not until He sent an angelic company to offer a way of escape to any who would believe the word of God. There is a place called hell. It's a real place. It's a literal place. It's a burning, fiery place of torment. Right. And look what God has done to keep one single soul from entering that place of punishment. I'm telling you, God is not willing that any should perish, and He's not willing that any saved man or woman should continue one more day in the torment and the unhappiness of sin. Now the Bible says in 1 John, let's go there. 1 John chapter 1. I'm going to read these verses out of order, not to suggest they're in the improper order, but for the sake of our study and our purposes this morning. Verse 8. If we say that we have no sin, that's not something we do, that's something we are. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. It doesn't matter that you deceive me. It doesn't matter that the whole church thinks you're doing okay. It doesn't matter that you've carefully hidden whatever it is that's going on in your heart or in your life or in your home. David carefully concealed, or at least he thought, all that he had done for the past year or more. But who was deceived? Not God. David. Who's deceived by my crimes and cover-up? Not God. Myself. We deceive ourselves. Now verse number 10. If we say that we have not sinned, there's the activity. There's the acting out of that which is in our heart. We make Him a liar. And His word is not in us. Well, I don't think I've done anything wrong. Well, then God lied. Well, I don't think what I did is all that bad. What are we doing? In defending ourselves, we must make God the liar, not self. Well, that's not a good position to be in. So what do we do about this sin that is part of our nature and this sin that is part of our doing? Verse 9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful. David wasn't. I'm not. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just. David wasn't. You're not. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's as though God so wants to make us clean that all He asks us to do is come clean. If we would just stop pretending we're something we're not, God could help us. If we would just stop denying that we're doing what we know we're doing, God could help us. But there's something about that deep-seated pride in the human heart. I'll call God a liar before I'll let Him bless me. I'll deny the Word of God before I'll take that joy the Lord wants to pour out into my life. Is it any wonder the Bible says we deceive ourselves? David finally, after figuring out a way to commit adultery, after figuring out a way to keep his adultery from being known, after figuring out a way to murder his rival, who wasn't really even his rival, after figuring out a way to cover up the murder, a preacher walked in one day and said, "Thou art the man." And David said, I've gone on with this as long as I can. I just got to be honest with God. Now, what you don't have in that one verse in 2 Samuel is God's examination of David's heart, which after his repentance, David would write for all the world to see. Come to Psalm 51. Psalm number 51. And as soon as the pages stop turning, we'll address the day and age in which we live. I don't know what it was like in former ages. I've read books, but books don't really tell the tale. But I know in this day and time, talk is so cheap. And words are often so void of any meaning. People say, "I love you," with no supporting evidence whatsoever. They just throw that phrase out. People say, "Oh my God," 1,000 times a day, and they don't even want to talk to Him. They just throw that phrase out there. And people say, "I'm sorry," as though they meant it. We're not talking about what people say. We're talking about what God sees when He looks in their heart. And David was not forgiven because he said, "I'm sorry." He was forgiven because he was sorry. You understand? We're dealing with God. It doesn't matter that you apologize to me. It doesn't matter that you told somebody else, "Oh, we're good." It doesn't matter that you walk in the church door and say, "Oh, fine, everything's fine." It doesn't matter how you throw around words that you don't mean. God looks upon the heart. And when God looked in David's heart, He saw the words that we have in Psalm 51. Do you have the introduction, the preface in your Bible to Psalm 51? How many of you have that in your Bibles? "To the chief musician, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came unto him after he had gone into Bathsheba." I want you to think about this. "Bring me that woman. Take her home. Send me Uriah. Put him out in the forefront of the battle. Uriah's dead. Bathsheba's going to have a baby. David sits down and writes Psalm 51. Have mercy upon me, O God. He gets to the end of the psalm. And then he goes back to the top. And he writes, this is what God did for me after I committed adultery. This is what God did for me after I murdered a man to cover it up. Take that to the chief musician. Tell the church to learn that song. You know what that is? That's a man that God's done something in his heart. That's a man that spent a year and a half trying to hide something, and now he's going to tell the whole wide world what he did to God and what God did for him. Something's happened in his life. It's not idle words. It's not vain talk. It's not a phrase or an expression thrown about with no substance to it. David meant business with God. And God did business with David. Psalm 51 verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. David stands, a guilty man, in the presence of a holy God. And he appeals to God on the basis of God's love, God's kindness, God's tenderness, God's mercy. Do you understand, brother? Your sin did not change God. Sister, do you understand? Whatever it is you've fallen into, it didn't alter who God is. He is today loving. He is today kind. He is today tender. He is today merciful. Would you stop running from God? Would you stop hiding from God? Well, after what I've done, after what you've done, He's who He's always been. Well, after how far I've fallen, no matter how far you've fallen, He is still who He's always been. You've got no other hope. You've got nowhere else to go. Nobody else can fix this. David realized. When Nathan said, thou art a man, the whole thing broke in his heart. The whole thing came crashing in upon his soul. And David realized, I've been torturing myself. Trying to keep the only one who knows what I did from knowing what I did. Trying to keep the only one who can help me from interfering. Verse 2. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. So what is confession? Well, he declares to God what the Almighty already knows. His sin has made him dirty. His iniquity has defiled him. But now there's no cloak for his failure. There's no means adopted to keep his condition hidden. He asks the Lord to wash him and cleanse him. It's just that simple. It's within he's defiled. And he knows it. And he longs for the purity of the sinless Lord to sweep through him and take away the guilt and the shame and take away the iniquity in his heart that caused him to do what he did. It just seems to carry a lot more weight than just saying, I'm sorry, and go on doing what you've been doing. These aren't flippant words of a careless man. Verse 3, for I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. He's crossed the line. He admits it. He's broken the laws of the Lord. He admits it. It's not a mistake. It's not a slip up. It's not somebody else's fault. It's not, well, you don't know the whole story. It's not, well, I had every right to. He just finally owns up. to who and what he is before God. You're still blaming somebody else, you're not sorry. You're still making excuses for why you did it, you're not sorry. If you're still talking about, well, somebody else did worse than me, you're not sorry. David said, my sin, my iniquity, my transgression, my guilt, I'm dirty. God, help me. You got to read an old church history book to read about a mourner's bench. A mourner's bench. People didn't come to an altar and pray awkwardly until they realized the piano had gone into one more verse than they were supposed to. And then they stayed before God all night long if that's what it took to make sure their heart was right. Don't see much of that these days. Not time for that these days. Who would suggest I need that these days? I said I was sorry. David's doing more than saying he's sorry. He wants to be clean. Verse 4, against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. See, before he lied to Joab and the troops, before he sought to destroy Uriah, before he took Bathsheba into his arms, David had fallen into sin. You know, we're not going back through all that again. On the rooftop with his eyes, on the rooftop with his heart. Before he sinned against that woman, before he sinned against her husband, before he sinned against his soldiers, before he sinned against his nation, before he sinned against his family, he sinned against God. Sinned against God. Can you sit there this morning and say, well, I know what the Bible says, but... Well, I know what the Scripture says, but I... Come on. Come on. Well, I'd never do that. You've already done the worst. I'd never perform that deed. You've already done the greatest misdeed. David said, worse than murder, worse than adultery, I sinned against the Lord. Oh, this is a day. Our nation, morally, spiritually, it's in ruins. You know that. Our churches, moral and spiritually, they're crippled at best. But what is a nation but its people? What is a church but its people? We imagine that until I commit adultery, I've not sinned. And until I murder someone, I've not sinned. That if I were to do those things, I could make some excuse for it. And I could find somebody to tell me, oh, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. You just got to love yourself. What David said, this thing's been killing me. I've got to finally admit it. God, I sinned against you. Sinned against you. Verse 5, behold, I was shapen in iniquity. And sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. We're not going to debate the theology of inborn sin, Adamic nature, fallen man, original sin. We can do all that some other time. I'm sure you'd be glad to do that. You know what David said? God, it wouldn't be enough for me to turn back the clock to a year and a half ago. I wasn't any good then. God, it wouldn't do me any good to turn back the clock when I was a shepherd boy. It wouldn't do me any good. It wouldn't do me any good to turn back the clock to when I went off to school the first time. It wouldn't do me any good, Lord, to go back to the cradle. God, without you, I've never been any good. This didn't start when I saw that woman. It's who I've always been. This didn't start when I fell that night. It's just, God, it's just who I am. You've got to cleanse me. Turning back the clock won't fix this. I need you to do a work in my heart to make me something I couldn't be if I was reincarnated 100 times. People say, I'd just live my life over again. You'd live it the same way or worse. If I just had that to do over again, you'd make as big a mess out of it as you did before. If God isn't allowed to have control of your life. I don't know if ladies do this, but I've been in a lot of conversation with men, and they say something like this. You young fellas, you don't do this yet, but men sit around, they say, you know what? If I, knowing what I know now, if I could go back and go to high school again, you'd be a monster. Well, no, I'd use all the good stuff I've learned. Yeah. Well, you know, if I had that opportunity again, you know what that is? We think somehow if you put me in a spot where I could give it a second try, that me would do better this time than me did last time. You know what David said? I don't care where you put me, me's the problem.
Sure. Amen.
I don't care how many chances you give me, me is not going to get it right. I'll try a new job, I'll try a new wife, I'll try a new husband, I'll try a new way to spend money, I'll try a new hobby, I'll try a new church. It's still you.
Right.
You know what David said? This problem didn't start with Bathsheba. This problem didn't start when I was a boy and my dad was mean to me. This problem didn't start when I was young and my mom didn't give me enough attention. This problem goes back to the womb. It goes back to the garden. The problem is man without God. God, if you don't come and do something in my heart, I'll just make another mess. Have you ever repented? I didn't ask if you ever said you're sorry. We're reading about a man who's repentant. It's big. It goes deep. It's thorough. The Bible says in verse number 6, behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, in the hidden part. Thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. This is tough in a mixed crowd of polite people on a Sunday morning, but most of us know what purging is. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. That's outside. That comes second. Give me some hyssop to purge me. You know what he said? God, would you just wash out of my inside man everything dirty and nasty and defiling and corrupting? Oh, modern day repentance is fix the makeup, fix the hair, fix the smile, wash the hands. Look, see, that's not the place to start. The Lord starts by putting something inside the man, inside the woman that's going to drive out the corruption and the impurity. It's not pleasant to think about, but that's what David asked for. Clean me inside, clean me outside. I need it, Lord, I need it. Verse 8, make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Well, he's got the girl. He saw her. She's beautiful. He wants her. He got her. He said, Lord, I miss when I had joy. He got rid of the man. He killed him. He's buried. Nobody caught him. No trace. Lord, I sure wish I was glad again. Now he's taking her. They're married. David and Bathsheba married. Husband, wife. You got the beautiful woman. He's still on the throne. The story never hit the newspapers. The baby's about to be born. All the paparazzi going to be there to get the first photo of the new baby, of the new queen. You know what David said? I got everything I wanted and I don't want it. I want joy. I want gladness. I thought that would make me happy. I thought that would make me happy. I thought that would make me happy. I thought if I could get rid of that and bring that in. And people sit here this morning, you can't remember the last time you had joy. You can't remember the last time gladness ruled your heart. And you think it's everybody else's fault but yours. Why don't you just let God cleanse you? Why don't you just come clean with God so He can make you clean? You can get that joy back and that gladness back. He says, the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. I read 2 Samuel 11, didn't you? I read chapter 12, didn't you? I don't read any trip to the orthopedic surgeon. Ask Julian. If broken bones cause you constant pain, he'll probably say yes. Ask Linda if broken bones cause everything you do to be unpleasant, uncomfortable. You know, David said, God, ever since the day I sinned against you, every step I've taken has been an unhappy one. My home's unhappy. My thoughts are unhappy. My friendships are unhappy. The church I loved's an unhappy place. The town I lived in and wanted to... You know what he said? Oh God, I want my bones to rejoice again. I want to be happy again on the inside. God, if you'd only make Joab be nice to me. God, if you'd only have Nathan quit preaching in my face. God, if you'd only let the kingdom shine bright. You know what he said? I know why my bones ache. I know why I'm happy on the inside. Because I'm not right with you, God. You ever repented? Really? I mean, really? You ever just gotten right with God? Verse number 9, hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. In the Old Testament, God put sins behind His back, said He'd never turn and look on them. Today, they're under the precious blood of His dear Son. God will have to do it. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. How will you know when you've repented? So it won't be about what the other person did anymore. It'll be about you. It won't be God fix him, God fix her, God make them understand, God have people see it my way. When the time comes to get right with the Lord, your prayer, my prayer will be create in me a clean heart. Oh God, renew a right spirit within me. In a couple of months, we'll get to look at the moral teachings of Jesus. He said something like this. Love your enemies. Pray for them that despitefully use you. Bless them that curse you. You know what Jesus said? I'm not concerned about how somebody treated you. I want to know, how's it going in your heart? I didn't ask you if the world lined up so that everybody let you have your way. I asked, how's it going in your heart? How's things in your heart? You know what David said? Create in me. In me. In me. God, would you come? Look at the word. Create in me a clean heart. God is so powerful. Listen, He's so powerful. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth by the word of His power. Look, one moment there's nothing there. The next moment there's the heavens and the earth. By God's creative power. Do you know how fast He could change your heart? Do you know how thoroughly and completely He could fix your heart? David's asking for the creative power of God to bring light out of darkness, to bring life where there was no life, to bring joy and gladness where there has been sorrow and broken bones. Do you believe this morning? Do you believe this morning that God said, sun, and there was one? God said, moon and stars, and there they were. God spoke the plant life into existence. Do you believe that? Then why don't you believe you could leave here this morning with your joy back and your gladness back and your peace back and your righteousness back? Why don't you believe God could create in you a new heart? He can. And He will. The moment you want it. Verse number 11, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. That's not capital H, capital S. That's not the third person of the Godhead. Look what he says. Verse 10, my spirit's not right. Verse 11, your spirit is holy. God, I need your spirit to overrule my spirit. I need your spirit to govern my spirit. Anybody here could use a dose of that this morning? Anybody here cared enough to ask for it this morning? See, that's the Lord. Verse 12. I'm going to read this as some denominations would read it. I'm going to read this as some individuals read it. And then we'll read it as God wrote it. Restore unto me thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Now, David was given what Acts calls the sure mercies. He didn't lose salvation. Just as many of you this morning have not lost salvation. What he's asking for, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. You know, there's saved people this morning in this town, across this nation, and they didn't enjoy church this morning, and they're not going to, and they didn't enjoy reading their Bible last night, and they have no intention to, and they didn't enjoy Christian fellowship this week, and they have no plans of enjoying Christian fellowship last week. And if you'll ask them what the problem is, they'll say it's me. But wait, you left church and you don't listen to me preaching anymore, and you don't come to me for counsel anymore, and you're as miserable 10, 15 years later as you were when you left. How could I be the problem? There are people all over this country. They're mad at some deacon who did this, or some church person who did this, or some family in the church who did that, or somebody that... Seriously? Where's that in Scripture? I nailed Jesus Christ to a cross. He said he went there for the joy that was set before him. He said, my delight's in my Heavenly Father. I do always those things that please Him. There's a million people every 5 minutes curse Jesus Christ. He hadn't quit church. He's still the head of the church. He hadn't quit being good to people. He's good to us every single morning. You know what the problem is? I got sin in my life, and I'm looking for somebody to blame rather than repent. I've lost the joy of my salvation, and it couldn't be my fault. It's got to be his fault, or her fault, or that guy's fault, or everybody's fault, or Obama. It's Obama's fault. You know what David said? Lord, I've lost the joy of my salvation, and I want it back. I don't want to live like this the rest of my life. I don't want to live like this another day. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me, thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. You say, how could a man done the awful things that David had done teach anybody about God's ways? Because he could tell the sinners he was talking to how merciful God is to sinners. He could tell the sinners he was ministering to how gracious God is to sinners. Nobody's pointing you this morning to me. Nobody's pointing you this morning to the people in this church. We're pointing you to the Lord. We're all sinners. We've all come short of the glory of God. And we all know how gracious he is. We all know how merciful he is. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. What you been singing about in the living room? What have you been singing about in the yard? What have you been singing about in the kitchen? What have you been singing about on the telephone? What have you been singing about in the hallways of the church house? God give you back the song you used to sing.
Amen.
He'll give you back the fervor with which you used to sing it. He'll give you back that, oh, we're only singing four today?
Sure.
You say, what replaced that with, man, if we sing one more song, we're going to be in here to, it'll be noon before we get out of here. Where'd that come from? Didn't come from God. Didn't come from God. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. What have you been talking about this week? You got a chance to talk this morning, last night, yesterday afternoon. If you had a chance to talk to one person about one thing, what was it? Didn't used to be that. What was it? If it wasn't the Lord, why wasn't it? If it wasn't praising God, why wasn't it? If it wasn't how good God's been to you, why wasn't it? I said, well, somebody sinned. Everybody sins every day. What happened that took your heart from God? David got that dealt with in a moment of time. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. You know, David's in a real bind. They've been reading those hyperdispensational books, and David realized reading those books that he was under the law and he had to get saved by his good works, and the only way he could get saved in the time he was living in was by law keeping. David probably didn't have any of those books, but if he did, he'd been in a rough spot, because if you read the Old Testament law, there is no sacrifice that God will accept for the sin of murder. You have to die. And there is no sacrifice that God will accept for the sin of adultery. None. It is a death penalty offense without sacrifice. He said, God, if I could bring you something, I'd bring it. But there's nothing acceptable. If I could give you something, I'd give it to you, God, but there's nothing that'll fix this. And the Lord said to David, my grace can fix it. My mercy can fix it. Your religion can't fix it. Your redoubling your efforts can't fix it. Your trying harder can't fix it. Just come to God. Just come to God and repent. Just come to God and acknowledge what you've done and where you are and how far you've fallen from where you used to be. Nothing in your hand. Nothing to impress Him, nothing to buy Him off, nothing to make God say, wow, I needed that dead animal. Just bring Him your heart. Bring Him your willingness to be cleansed. Verse 17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken, a contrite heart, O God, Thou wilt not despise. Now I'll show you something. Verse 10. Create me a clean heart, O God. You don't know what a clean heart is? Look at verse 17. A broken and a contrite heart, O God, Thou wilt not despise. Look at verse 10. Renew a right spirit within me. What is a right spirit? Verse 17. The sacrifice of God or a broken spirit? My father complained bitterly about the music I listened to in my younger days. Just as no doubt the fathers of the former generation had complained about that swing and that Benny Goodman and that perverted doing what comes naturally stage music and all that. But you know something? The music of our day, they've almost removed the music from it altogether. And now it's just a string of defiant chants. They call it rap, they call it hip-hop, they call it or whatever they're calling it this week. You know what it is? It's a man with no talent. It's a man who can't find pants that fit. It's a man that couldn't open a safe deposit box at the bank, so he has to wear his gold around his neck. That man gets up on the stage with enough parts to fix his car in his ears and his lips. And he takes that microphone, he looks in the camera, and he says, I'm mad at this, I'm mad at that, I'm mad at this, I'm mad at that, and none of it's my fault. It's not my fault, it's not my fault, it's his fault, it's her fault, it's your fault, it's their fault, it's the man's fault. You know something? People may not watch that. But it's reflective of the culture. It doesn't set the culture, it reflects the culture. People choose the music as it matches their heart. They choose their political leaders because it matches their heart. They choose their fashion because it matches their heart. People walk in a church and their life's a mess, and their heart's a mess, and their thoughts are a mess, and their home is a mess, and their finances are a mess, and they look you right in the eye and say, it's not my fault. It's not my fault. It's the man's fault. It's the woman's fault. It's the government's fault. It's the church's fault. It's Obama's fault. It's the world's fault. It's the devil's fault. You know what David said? When I finally got to the place where I let God break my heart, God could clean my heart. When I finally got to the place where I humbled my spirit, God could renew in me a right spirit. Doesn't hurt to repent. It's a good thing to repent. Doesn't hurt to come clean before God. It's a good thing to come clean before God. Somebody said a couple of weeks ago, I honestly, I don't remember who it was. I don't remember what message it was. So I'm just saying this because it's Somebody said, there's no way I was going to the altar after that sermon. Because then people would know that was about me. Hey, boys and girls, they're all about me. Every one of them is about me, and every one of them is about you. Let's deal with it. Verse 20. Do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. This is so perfect. You know what happens the minute that guy gets his heart right? All of a sudden, he cares about somebody besides himself. Yeah. Right. No, well, how will I know if I really got right with God? Because everything won't be about you anymore.
Yeah.
How you feel and how you see it and how you were treated and how what somebody said to you and what somebody did to you. Hey, if you get right with God, all of a sudden you want Jerusalem blessed and you want America blessed and you want your church blessed. You want everybody blessed by God. That's how you'll know. Well, you know, it wasn't the sermon I wanted to hear. Well, it wasn't. Why is it about you? Well, I didn't sing the songs I want him to sing this morning. Well, yeah. Why is that thing about you? Man, I got to the gas station. There were three cars in front of me. You know what? You ain't got nowhere to go. There are two people been waiting there. Somebody's in front of them. We were down there. We were preaching on the street down in Hobe Sound, was the name of the town. And the traffic was backed up as far as you could see in every direction. No offense, I'm not, but it's from the license plates. It's retired snowbirds going to an all-day art show, and it's 10 in the morning. And the minute the light would change, they're mashing their horns. You got nowhere to go. The art show's going to last another 8 hours. You're retired. You're living in Florida. You got enough money to have two houses. Cool it. You know what the problem is? I got two homes. I got retirement money. I got a nice car to live in. I'm going to an art show. But somebody's slowing me down. You know what that is? That's just a heart that ain't right with God. You come clean with the Lord, all of a sudden everything won't be about you. This poor little girl comes to the table. Can I take your order? Yes. I'd like the all you can eat, every part of the pig. I'd like the unlimited beans. And I'd like a mountain of macaroni and cheese. I'm sorry, sir, we're out of macaroni and cheese. Are you kidding me? What do you mean you don't have any macaronis? Just eat the pig. You can have the whole pig for $15. And you're chewing out some little girl because you can't get macaroni and cheese. You know what that is? It's just a nation full of people so in love with themselves, they just can't see anything beyond how they feel at the moment. There are people sitting here this morning, spent years in the jungles of Vietnam, having to kill and be killed, they know not why. Watching their friends die around them, spending the evening burning leeches off their legs, fighting off disease and everything else. Come home and come to church and listen to somebody complain about how their parking place was taken. Look, if until you get right with God, there's no perspective. There's no realistic perspective. You got free housing, free food, free medicine, free internet, free phone. And you'll vote for a man that offers you change. Because life isn't good enough yet. One day you're going to get a man going to give you a change. He's going to take all that away from you. Look what he says. Do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. As soon as God renewed a right heart in him, all of a sudden he cares about others, not himself. All of a sudden he wasn't interested in me, myself, and I, but he was interested in the city and the nation. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offering. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar. I have one last thought for you this morning, and then we'll pray. Verse 17, and go back to 2 Samuel chapter 12. Second Samuel chapter 12. I don't know what you've done this morning. I don't. Maybe it's just carelessness. Maybe it's some terrible sin. Maybe it's just drifting away from the Lord. Maybe it's a crime against humanity. I don't know. But I want to show you something about God. The God of the Bible. 2 Samuel 12, verse 9. This is Nathan to David, sent by God. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord? David despised God's commandments. Psalm 51, verse 17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Let me tell you why God's different than any man or woman you've ever met or ever will meet. Only God, only God. If you'll repent, He will not hold it against you. There's nobody else on this earth that has that much grace and that much mercy and that much love and that much kindness. David despised the Lord. And as soon as he repented, you know what David said? God didn't despise me. God's not looking to get even with you. He's looking to help you. He's not looking to settle the score. He's looking to give you joy and peace and gladness. The life more abundant that you can only have from Him. Say, man, if I came to God, I don't know what He'd do to me. I know exactly what He'd do to you.
Yeah.
He'd wash you, He'd cleanse Amen. You, He'd renew you. He'd give you back your joy. I can't even comprehend a God like that. But I'm glad I have one. It boggles my mind. If I just thought for 5 minutes about some people that have done some things to me and how I'd... Then I'm right back where we started. Oh God. In iniquity I conceived. There's nothing good in me, but the Lord, whatever that thing is you got, whatever that thing is in your life, you bring it to Him, He won't despise you. He won't hold it against you. What a God. Our Father, I pray this morning for, first of all, that man, that woman, that young person that has never been saved. I pray, Lord, they would come to the sin-cleansing, sin-pardoning Savior of the world and leave here today with eternal life. But Father, I pray for those that have not lost salvation but have somewhere along the way lost the joy of that salvation. I pray, Father, they would come and find how graciously You deal with those who repent. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand with our blue books. There are people already at this altar praying. Number 332. Let's sing from our hearts. My Jesus, I love thee. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. Let's come do business with God this morning while we sing number 332.
My Jesus, I love thee, I know. Father.